receives me. Yeah, they could have stayed there. And whoever receives me receives the one who sends me. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. On this great night in which our Lord is betrayed, there is a juncture between the hour of evil and what he calls his hour. We saw that as to the first moment in Cana, when Our Lady recognizes that there is no wine left at the banquet, the wedding. And he winds up, she says to him, they have no wine, and he says to her, that my hour has not yet come. It's okay, gentlemen, come on. This is why we don't put the chairs away. No, thank you. Less work for me after. But on the night of our Lord's agony, he winds up speaking about the hour of darkness. So that on this Thursday, the beginning of the 3 days of our Lord's Passion, we have a coincidence, a coinciding of our Lord's free choice of his hour and the hour of darkness, which overlap each other. So that what becomes the moment in which evil and selfishness and the demonic, several times in the Gospels, we're told by St. Luke that the devil pushes Judas during these days to betray our Lord finally. St. John in his Gospel speaks that the moment that Judas leaves the Last Supper, that the devil enters him. And there's a true case of possession here. There is a moment then of these 2 hours that coincide, because what our Lord is doing is embracing death that is the signal effect of the sin of our first parents. Death is an effect of the selfishness of what Adam and Eve do. So that what becomes an effect to the human race that afflicts us down to this very generation of suffering and pain and death, our Lord embraces freely that effect and that signal effect in order to turn it on its head and to bring life to the world. It's why the hour of darkness and its selfishness, where the devil really thinks at this moment that he's finally gotten rid of this horrible, pesky rabbi from Nazareth. But our Lord is always choosing freely for this moment, which is why he chooses this Passover. He chooses to go on this day. And on this night when he's arrested and they find him in the garden, and Judas kisses him, gives him a sign of friendship. Our Lord is still in control because it is his hour. And he asks in that dark garden, he says, who are you looking for? And they say, Jesus of Nazareth. And he says, I am he. And at that point, the soldiers fall backward on the ground when our Lord speaks to them. This causes great disturbance among the soldiers, witchcraft. But it shows that our Lord is in control even at the moment of his arrest. Judas, who thought that he had put things in their place, when he sees that our Lord, for the very first time in years, does not simply pass through their midst and escape arrest as he had done so many times before. It's the purpose of another sermon at some point. What is Judas doing this night? Judas is very human. He's not demonic. But he is manipulative, like we are fundamentally by original sin. We try to make things work out the way we think they should be, whether it's our spouse, our children, our parents, our colleagues. And so when Judas sees that our Lord, certainly when he sees the soldiers tumble down on the ground, he thinks, that's it. He's going to do another one of these great moments. And when he watches our Lord allow himself to be chained and taken away under arrest, that is the beginning of the despair and that demonic influence of the hour of darkness that leads to his suicide. And Judas, this night, will hang himself in despair tomorrow, within these 24 hours. And apparently we're told in the scriptures that the rope must have broken because the body falls forward and his guts rupture out in the drop. This hour of darkness is won. And when our Lord arrives at that last moment on Calvary and his death, he says in a loud voice, we are told, "It is finished, it is consummated, I have accomplished." But he says it in a loud voice, because you know, I'll talk about this a bit tomorrow, when they die in crucifixion, you suffocate, you asphyxiate. So that at the end, usually you just stop breathing. But our Lord at that last moment says, "It is consummated, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And we're told he leans forward and he breathes forth his spirit. Our Lord is always in control. This is his hour of overturning selfishness and self-centeredness and sin and death on its head. Which is why among our fathers, in the Eastern tradition especially, the Syriacs, they refer to our Lord as being medicine. In the Western tradition, it's been a bit kind of disproportional, well, not disproportional, is not the correct word. It's been a bit warped, where the idea is that Jesus dies on the cross and somehow we all get a free ticket to go somewhere that we call heaven. But that's not at all the vision at the origin. What our Lord is doing for the human race, he is doing in his person, in his sacred humanity. He is transforming this body that he received, this human life that he has embraced and become from the womb of the Mother of God. And he is transforming that human nature within himself so that we may be able to partake in him and receive that divine medicine. So our Lord is referred to by the fathers, especially the Eastern fathers, as being the medicine of God, of being the tree of life, and the tree of life which is protected by fire in the Garden of Paradise, signifying the death of those first human beings. So the choice that they made in causing the death, our Lord chooses freely to bring that tree of immortality into his own person, to be that tree of life. Now I was looking before the Mass, I was looking at the older prayers that we have in Bishop Dwight's old spiral books, those beautiful translations from the Syriac manuscripts. And what is used as the first image on this night is the prayer of our Lord as the consuming fire, before whom the angels cannot bear to look upon. The seraphim in the vision of Isaiah the prophet, who cover their faces, "Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts," before the divine throne of fire. And so what they do is, it's contrasting, as we do in the poetry of the Syriac imagery, that the one who is the consuming fire, of whom St. Paul speaks in his letters, that this consuming fire upon whom the watchers, the spirits themselves, dare not look, washes the feet of 12 men tonight. This contrast between this sublime and divine majesty who chooses to show us a way. So that what we have this night is the consuming fire, the medicine of God, who then gives the means for that medicine to be transferred through the Holy Eucharist, which is why this is the great Thursday of the Divine Mysteries, which is the Eucharist. But the Eucharist is inseparable from the priesthood. Do this in my name. Do this. This is my body. This is my blood. And that divine Eucharist, which is nothing other than our Lord's substantial presence, that divine medicine of Christ, is then made possible to be extended throughout time and space from generation to generation. Which is why when we finish this Mass, we take the divine mysteries, and we'll make a bit of a procession around, and we will take them down to St. Jude's, which has been nicely and very tastefully simply decorated for this night. And you are welcome to spend time in adoration, especially now that we have all the chairs back down there. and spend some time in thanksgiving to our Lord for giving us this possibility to touch Him, to receive Him in communion. We have something sublime of gifts that cannot be duplicated by anyone outside of the Catholic Church. So that what the reality is, as I mentioned, we have a warped idea that because this rabbi died 2,000 years ago, somehow we all get free passes to go someplace called heaven. The reality is that what this rabbi does in his death and resurrection is allow us to become him, to allow us to enter him, to allow us to receive this divine medicine. As St. John says, what we have seen, what we have heard, what we have touched with our hands, we also share with you. And from generation to generation, that has been the reality within that mystery that we call the Church. Which is why last night on the anointing, we talked about the inn in the parable of the Good Samaritan as being the Church. It's the place where we are picked up, being left half dead at the side of the road by original sin and by our own personal sins. But the Good Samaritan, the divine Good Samaritan, takes and places within the inn for our rest and our reconstitution, as he says, until I return. And in that Syriac tradition, we wait in that inn. And we desire that return of the Samaritan who saved our lives and made it possible for us to enter into the consuming fire of the divine light. It's not a place that we go to. It is a mode of existence that we are allowed to participate in and to become. You know the story of one of the great fathers of the desert, Abbot Saman, I think. I forget the name, which one it is. John of Dalyatha. Make sure you keep that in the note. And when one of the disciples, one of the inquirers, goes out to see Abba John, and they always say, Abba, give me a word. Tell me something which will give me the benefit to enter into the mystery of Christ. And St. John speaks about prayer. And they go back and forth and they discuss this idea of prayer. But the man who's inquiring wants to know more. And so at that point, Abba John stands up and he lifts his hands in prayer, and from him fire shoots out of his hands into the sky. And he says, if you wish, you can become fire. This is the teaching that through this divine medicine, we are given not a place to go, but an existence to live today. Not something which happens somewhere along the line that we hope to get into because maybe Jesus won't see our sins. But to have those sins consumed now, in this mode, in this day, in this week, in this month. Not something put off, but to receive from the tree of life, to receive the divine medicine, and to render gratitude and thanks for the great gifts that God Himself has given us in this great example that He shows of being subjected, and to be humble before one another, which is why He says, we finish with that thought, you call me Lord and you call me Master, and you say rightly, for so I am. And then He continues telling the apostles at the Last Supper, so if I, your Lord and Master, your Rabbi, your teacher, do this to serve you, so you must also do to one another. We have an external example of how to act, because we are consumed by the inner divine fire within us. These are the mysteries of this night. These are the mysteries that we render gratitude and thanksgiving for. These are the things that we stand and we kneel in awe before the tree of life restored to the human race on this night that He freely chose to overturn the coinciding hour of evil on its head. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God, Father Almighty, Creator.